to my channel. Today I would like to introduce you to a book called Hidden Champions of the 21st Century. This book is authored by Hermann Simon, who is a well-known German author and a business thinker. He is voted as the best management thinker after Peter Drucker in German-speaking countries. So what are these hidden champions? So Hermann Simon researched companies across the world and he identified some companies which qualified as hidden champions. So his main area of research was the German market, but he also looked at companies outside Germany. So unlike large corporations, these hidden champions remain relatively unexplored. Very few people would be knowing about these companies. So most likely these hidden champions would be popular in their home markets, but in spite of their significant market share, global market share, in most cases above 50% and in some cases even higher, these companies are relatively unknown outside their home country. They are usually number 1, 2 or 3 in the global market in terms of market share and most likely number 1 in the continent, but with revenues below $4 billion. And there is a low level of public awareness of these companies. This is purely from a qualitative point of view. So Hermann Simon has tried to quantify many things. He has researched these companies by various data. He has analyzed data from different countries. He wanted to see if there are any common patterns among these hidden champions. But what he found is these hidden champions are largely diverse companies and there is no clear-cut pattern. So they are found in many countries. But there is no clear-cut pattern or there is no bias as such in these hidden champions. So moving on, there are various chapters in the book which focus on different factors and which are of significance with respect to the hidden champions. So I would like to touch upon some of these aspects. So the first one is market and focus. So these there are quite a few hidden champions which operate in very narrow markets. For example, if you take a company like Tetra, it operates in a segment which is very narrow, which is fish food. So now they have diversified to other products such as reptile food and maybe a few accessories for the aquarium. But their focus has been very narrow. And similarly, there are companies like which manufacture the zipper of a pant. So these are examples of focused companies. Then there is another chapter on globalization. So Hermann Simon talks about companies which have a lot of subsidiaries in foreign companies. So these are companies which are relatively unknown, but they operate small plants in various parts of the world. So one example is SL Propack, which is an Indian company which manufactures toothpaste. They don't manufacture the paste, they just manufacture the tube of the toothpaste. So they operate in 20 plus countries and they're relatively unknown company. It's a relatively unknown company. And then there is a chapter on companies, product and services. So this is an example where he talks about companies which have close relationship with customers. So these are companies which are which have a significant customer concentration. So meaning they work with one or two significant customers, or one or two significant customers would account for majority of the business of the hidden champion. So some people would view this as a risk in terms of customer concentration, but these companies have been working with those customers for years and the customers with whom they work are large corporations such as Boeing or Airbus, and they will have huge switching costs if they try to look for an alternate vendor. Hence, there is also an element of trust in those companies. Then going on to the next chapter on innovation. So this is again a very interesting chapter. So this talks about the importance of process innovations. So usually most people are think about innovation in terms of product innovation, but hidden champions bring a lot of process innovations, such as they have some ideas to reduce the cost and various aspects. So this chapter is more for qualitative and it is quite interesting. So you can understand what types of innovation the hidden champions undertake. And competition, coming to competition, the hidden champions, they operate in oligopolistic market. So they might be small companies, but they are number one or number two or number three player in the whole country or the whole continent. So there is very less scope for newer entrants there in these markets. Then there are other chapters on financing, organization, and business organization. So again, these are more of qualitative things. So there is no fixed pattern of financing or organization. And typically, some of the hidden champions tend to employ anywhere between 100 to 5,000 employees. So again, there is a wide gap between the smallest employer and the largest employer among the hidden champions. So I just took a few quotes from the chapter on focus. So classic hidden champion is typically a focused company. So one of the hidden champions, which is Krupp, the CEO of this company, has said, "We concentrate on what we do best." So they don't try to go for unnecessary diversification. And the management leaders of other hidden champions have quoted these three quotes. "We supply a niche market. We are deep, not broad. We stick to what we do," or "no diversification." So this was just one example of a hidden champion. So these are so typically there are a lot of hidden champions which are very focused companies. So instead of going through each chapter, which is more of a qualitative exercise, I thought of just introducing you to some of the global hidden champions which have been introduced in the book. So briefly, I would touch upon those hidden champions. So I have just titled "Selected Hidden Champions." So it's again from the book. There is an example of Badr. Badr is an Icelandic company where the term "badr man" is a very common term used for qualified mechanics. That is because this has become a household name there, and this company is the world's leading supplier of fish processing equipment. So this has a very high market share again. Then there is another company called McIlhenny. So this was founded in 1896. It has only one production site in Avery Island in the Louisiana, US. So Tabasco, the brand which McIlhenny manufactures, is the most preferred pepper sauce in the world. So in all probability, it has a market share of more than 80% in the pepper sauce market now by now. Then there are 3B Scientific. It's a German company. It's a global market leader in anatomical teaching aids. So if you happen to come across any anatomical aids like a skeleton or a model of a brain in a medical college or a hospital, so most likely the manufacturer of that particular equipment or a model is 3B Scientific. There is also another company called International SOS, which is a Singapore-based world leader in emergency rescue services. They have helped multiple times. So they also organized one flight between China and Taiwan, which was very rare in the last 50 years. So this is a company capable of handling very complex issues, and this is a world leader in emergency rescue services. Then coming to the next one, Höganäs and Höganäs Corp. These are two separate companies, though they originated from a common parent. So Höganäs is a German company, and Höganäs Corp is a US company right now. They are leading suppliers of metallurgical powder technology. So Höganäs Corp, the US company, is a leader in ferrite products, ferrite powders. So this is again a very niche and narrow market. Then coming to another example called Tetra, which is a household name in many countries. So Tetra is the maker of Tetramin, the most famous fish food for all ornamental fish. They also manufacture many other products in the similar space, like pet reptile food. They also manufacture some accessories for aquarium. Maybe the color you put in an aquarium for the water color, that also they manufacture. So this is again a German company. So moving on, Bobcat, which is based in North Dakota, US, it's a world leader in compact industrial construction and agribusiness equipment. So it employs over 3,000 employees, and it's a leading employer in North Dakota. Gallagher, so this is a company which is based in New Zealand. So the author says that in New Zealand, the population of human beings is around 3 million, and there are about 70 million sheep. So it's a natural market for electric fences where they want to restrict the cattle. So this company is a leading, it's a global leader for electric fences with over 80% market share. Then says Getters. So Getters are a chemical which is used in vacuums to generate some vacuum. So this is an Italian company with over 85% global market share in barium getters. So it's a specific type of getter. So it's so you can understand how narrow it can get for a hidden champion to operate. So Hamamatsu Photonics, this is a Japanese company. It's a world leader in various light sources and optical sensors. So their main area of business is photons or light. So that is their area of business. Then ARRI and Sasler, these are two German companies which are very well known in the motion picture business. So both the companies operate in the same business, but they manufacture very different types of products. So ARRI manufactures motion picture cameras, while Sasler manufactures accessories such as tripod. So these two are again two German companies which are hidden champions. So moving on, so I have not touched upon every company which is there in the book, because the author has literally studied thousands of companies and he lists at least 100 to 150 companies. But in the initial chapter, he lists around 30-40 companies, out of which I selected only a few, so that you can get a flavor of what this book is about. So coming to this company called Petzl, it's a French company which operates in the vertical world. So it's called a leading innovator in the world, vertical world. So what the vertical world means is it's the market of adventure sports. So Petzl is a leader in the manufacture of equipment for people who are adventurers. So who like to trek, who like to go for cave exploration and things like that. So I'm sure most of the companies what we discussed till now, you would not be aware of most of them unless you have studied them particularly in this book or any other case studies. So most likely you will not be aware of most of the companies. Maybe you would be aware of the companies which belong to your home country. So moving on, Lantel. So this is a Swiss company. So this is a very unique company again. It's a global leader in cabin interiors with 60% share. So they work with leading airlines, and more than 300 airline companies around the world have been their customers. Even the Singapore Airlines premier cabins have been designed by them. Lufthansa's premium business class cabins have been designed by them. So moving on, there are two other companies which are world leaders in video conferencing systems. One is Tandberg based in Norway and the other is Polycom in the US. So this is one space where I think there is a significant amount of disruption right now happening, with a lot of companies coming in the video conferencing space. So this is something which is more likely to be disrupted or already has been disrupted right now. So going on to SL Propack. So as I told earlier, this is an Indian company which is based in Mumbai, and it has 33% global market share in the toothpaste tubes business. It operates more than 20 plants across the world, including countries like Russia and Venezuela. So this is a hidden champion from India. So similarly, there is Orica, which is an Australian global leader in explosives for mines and quarries. So this is also a relatively unknown company with a significant market share. So moving on, I have not profiled every single company or told you about every single company, but I have selected a broad sample so that all the sectors and geographies are represented. So the conclusion what I reached by reading this book is typically these are low profile companies, and they spend less on advertising. And they are also not very hungry for capital. So many companies would be listed in the markets, like SL Propack is listed or Hamamatsu is listed in the Tokyo Stock Exchange. But most of the other companies may not be listed companies. They remain unlisted for reasons they want to operate in their own niche markets. And they don't really go for much acquisitions, or they don't diversify beyond their few product lines. There might be a few companies which go for diversification, but again, it's very less. So there is more focus on certain products and markets. Then typically most of them operate in the B2B segment, that is business to business segment, except a few which are in the B2C, like Tetra is in B2C segment. And the focus of is more on like the companies which have been selected. They are more from countries like Germany and Japan, where durability is given utmost importance. So you could say that anything that was German made or Japanese made would be more durable than something that is made in a country like China. So it's bound to be get biased a bit. Actually, there are more companies from these geographies. And second thing is the author himself is from Germany with more experience in the German market. So obviously he has selected more companies from German market. So there can be thousands of such micro niches or extremely focused markets. So he may not have gone through each and every possible business segment. So there is a bias towards the German market, but it is not significant. So the author has made an attempt to select hidden champions from across geographies. And another thing which I noticed is very few companies are from the technology space. Probably that is because this book was written a while ago, and it was more on the hidden champions which operate in very narrow markets. So they tend to be more from the manufacturing segment. But in case of technology, the technology companies would be more on the more concentrated in the Silicon Valley, and they also their origination would be totally different. They would be founded by a couple of people, high school graduates or college dropouts or something of that sort. But whereas a typical manufacturing company in the Europe has a legacy of 100 plus years. So this book was overall a good book, but at times it gets a bit dry, and because there is more focus on the academic nature. So that is one observation. So more or less you can gain a few lessons, and you could also search for hidden champions in your own home country. For instance, in India there are a few hidden champions. I will try to make a video on that in future. So thank you for watching till the end. So thank you.